morning, everyone. I'm Hunter Gaston.
I'm the Harvard respondent.
And I'm Hussein Al-Dawood.
And I'm Ron Walker.
So, what is a human-powered vehicle? It's exactly what it sounds like. It's any vehicle that uses the power of your muscles to move. Immediately, people just think of bicycles. But they're really not limited to just bicycles. As you can see, they're flying machines, submarines. To your right there is the AIDA machine. It was a recumbent bicycle that in 2016 broke the land speed record for HPVs. It went 89.6 miles per hour. In the past 25 years, or even 10 years, debate over global emissions has really ramped up. And obviously, if HPVs could be adopted, they would be able to greatly cut down on the emissions from transportation, which is about 25% per year historically for the past 25 years. However, human-powered vehicles do have drawbacks. If you've ever been caught out in the rain on your bike, you've experienced one firsthand. Also, obviously, bikes and other human-powered vehicles aren't as safe as, say, a car. However, the American Society of Mechanical Engineers is working to overcome some of these obstacles and some of these hurdles by encouraging advances in the industry through their college competition. They have four regional competitions every year where colleges from around the country come and compete in endurance tests, speed tests, and an innovation competition. Last year, Pitt formed a human powered vehicle club and competed for the first time. They placed 14th out of 33 teams. And moving forward, they would like to build on this success and really institute some innovation and new design in their bike.
And that's where we come in. So the Human Powered Vehicle Club at Pitt has one main goal in the short term, and it's to determine the optimal seating configuration for their bike. What frame is that? So what can they adjust the seat so that, what distance from the pedals is optimal? What angle is optimal? And in order to do this, they need certain information. They need how much power the user is outputting, as well as the pedal cadence that's also being outputted. And we need to figure that out. So we're going to create a power meter and a tester. And the system needs to be accurate within 5% error for all subsystems. And it needs to provide pedal cadence, as well as the torque that the user is providing to the bike, which will later be converted to power. Finally, everything needs to be wireless. Your bike, you can't have wires getting tangled up. So we had a test plan and we tackled it on that. Our test plan composed of three major units, which was one, we needed to create the power meter. Two, we needed to determine the ideal instrumentation, the electronics, as well as the wireless communication capability. And finally, three, we needed to create a tester so that they could test and see what the information was. So we tackled it one at a time and we asked ourselves, why not just buy a power meter? Well, it turns out that the market value cost for a power meter is $900 to $1,000. So we needed to actually build it ourselves. Similar to this, we kind of had to create an enormous test plan and make these decisions one at a time. Over here in yellow, you can see in progress, this is kind of our chart in the middle of our project. We were kind of determining what decisions we need to make. And in the end, we made them one at a time. The green represents the confirmed decisions we made, and the red represents the rejected ones. Obviously, we can't go over everything. And now we think we'll talk to you guys about the preliminary testing that we did.
Thank you. So, with the user first, we removed some of the materials from the front car to have two plus surfaces on the front car. It's going to be easier to mount all of the gauges on it. We use all the information that we know from the measurement class 1041 here. And then our circuit is a half-bridge circuit with only two strain gauges and operational amplifier to increase the signal of the strain gauges. With the calibration, we can have the trunk arm on strong vice, and then we hang a lot of masses on it, and we also record the voltage output from the strain gauges. We went up from 0 pounds up to 200 pounds, and as you can see from the plot, the relationship between like the voltage and the mass is almost a straight line.
So to go over our system diagram, we have two parallel subsystems talking. The first subsystem had a four strand sensor, which was composed of strain gauges, which were amplified to an op-amp circuit, as well as a Hall effect sensor, which would measure the revolutions per minute of the pedal. Both of these communicated directly with our microcontroller, our Arduino Uno, and the Arduino Uno then sent the data to a set of two transceiver and receiver XP radio modules. When the second radio module, the second XP, receives the data, it sends it to a second Arduino, and the Arduino finally sends the final data to an LCD display where it shows cadence as well as the pattern. So in the end, we needed to tackle accuracy within 5%. We needed to provide cadence as well as torque, and everything needed to be wireless. And that's exactly what we did with our portion sensor and our speed transducer together.
One of the biggest challenges we had was the budget. First, we had access to the class money from the last year competition. However, we did not. So, because like all the money went back to the school on June 1st. With this challenge, we were able to create the power meter for only a cost of $5, comparing to the market value, and also we were able to build the cluster for only $165 in cost.
So not only did we have to measure the power output and cadence of the rider, but the Human Powered Vehicle Club also needed some way to change their bike geometry to be able to look at that power and see how it affects different seating configurations. In order to do that, you need a test rig that has 3 degrees of freedom shown there with the bike seat in relation to the pedals. We needed to utilize pieces from last year's bike, and we started by brainstorming. You can see some of our preliminary design on the right. Because cost was a major consideration for this design, we decided to choose materials first. We utilized parts we already had from last year's vehicle. We researched online to find different ways to get adjustment and be able to hold the frame together, as well as utilizing bike parts in order to get the resistance for the pedals that we got from both our sponsor, the club, as well as local bike shops. In terms of analysis, we decided to start with the geometry of the actual test rig. This geometry was based off of the average length of someone's legs, as well as the average seat angle, or the seat tube angle from upright as well as recumbent bicycles. Once that geometry was set, we did supporting and structural analysis on both the back of the seat here, as well as on the tube holding the pedals there, because both of these components of the test rig would receive the force when it's in use. In parallel with that structural analysis, we started fabricating our test rig. Shown here, you can see the initial frame bolted together. Those are struts we bought and were folded in. The front stand is welded together, shown in the center, and one of our preliminary put it together pictures is on the right. Once that supporting analysis was done, we did determine that the clamp under the seat was not enough to support the moment put on that seat. We put on the back support. There's pieces you heard behind the seat there that are from last year's bicycle in order to keep the adjustability of the back end of the seat. We also put an extra support in on the front. This directs the force put into that front stand back into the frame and breathe everything. So to conclude for the test rig, we did achieve all 3 degrees of freedom that were necessary, and the test rig is structurally sound for testing.
And here's our final demonstration. As you can see on the left, a very handsome operator is utilizing the test rig that we created, and on the right is the LCD display, which is now in a state-of-the-art box. And that's our final.
So So the design could be actually improved by doing the followings. A compact design could be done to like all the components from the front car, and also adding two more gauges to do the temperature compensation on the front car, and also building another power meter to measure the torque on the other side of the crank. And with the test rig, sliding rails could be used instead of the climbing poles for quick and easy adjustments.
So overall, throughout the course of this project, we all had our own individual lessons learned.
Yeah, for me, teamwork is the key to success.
Now, I realized you don't know what you don't know. It's impossible to foresee these problems, but as they come, I take them one by one and tackle them head on.
In conjunction with that,